Hello. My name is John Bednar. I'm a professor of language and international trade at Clemson University in Clemson, South Carolina. And I'm here to tell you the fascinating story of a dedicated group of people in a small village in the French Alps. 20 years ago, life was increasingly difficult for the members of this traditional dairy farming community. The general pattern of their existence was a hard, double life for everyone. Husbands worked 8 hours a day in a factory in the valley, and then came home to work 4 or 5 more hours on the farm. Wives took care of the dairy cows, the children, and the house, often putting in more hours than their husbands. From before sunup to after sundown, they worked themselves to the bone 7 days a week. And it was practically impossible for them to produce the amount of milk from their cows that flatland farmers could produce. The hillsides and steep terrain had rich grass, but there was no way they could compete in an agricultural world where quantity was the password to success and where the European Union's quotas only made matters worse. Naturally, the children growing up and watching their parents slave away at an 85-hour work week took the first train out of town when they were old enough. Why be a slave to a small farm when you could work at the post office, make more money, work less than half the hours, and have 5 weeks of paid vacation a year? There were a few, however, who couldn't stand the idea of leaving such a beautiful setting for the pollution and noise of metropolitan France. They wanted to stay at home, get married, and raise children and grandchildren who would also stay. They wanted to preserve the tradition of people helping each other, a tradition that was centuries old in the valley. For as long as they could remember, people had been collectively participating in the survival of the community by making big wheels of rich mountain cheese, wheels that would last long enough to provide needed protein to the family at the end of the winter. Those wheels were produced in little factories called fruit co-ops. The fruit, by the way, was the fruit of their labors, not fruit from trees. And right before their eyes, a small village had practically quit producing milk, and the local fruit co-op had disappeared. Something had to change. In the face of every trend in agriculture at the time, they decided to follow the lead of Maxime Vialet, who was preaching quality instead of quantity, and who had managed to obtain the prestigious government label given to only 44 of France's 500 cheesemakers, guaranteeing top quality. They could limit their milk production, refine the genetics of their already hardy mountain cows, and concentrate on making their cheese superior so that they could get a premium price for it. In addition, they heard about a new economic formula for corporate farming that seemed to work in Switzerland, investigated it, and thought it might work for them. 8 men, 6 young and 2 middle-aged enthusiasts, banded together and created an agricultural corporation where they invested their livestock, cash, and time, but kept their land. After 10 years of hard work, years when their dedication had to withstand the jeers, jealousies, and mockery of old friends and acquaintances, their efforts paid off. They slowly left their double jobs to work full-time on the farm. They developed a tourist industry that brought city dwellers to see their beautiful mountains. And they slowly got to the point where their children went to the university to study mountain environmental engineering and tourism and came back home to raise families of their own. We're going to tell you how they did it.
Well, the group was formed, you see. We went to Switzerland to see some similar groups, ones like ours. And that's where it started. Since we saw people from all walks of life, there were doctors, there were, well, lots of different professions that were participating in partial farming corporations. That's what inspired us. And my colleagues and I decided to try and do the same thing. Our main reason was to alleviate the workload of our wives and to avoid a lot of fatigue. Like with the property we have, we could work, we could milk from morning to night, for God's sake. And then we had to hire so many people, hire lots of people, while still being on our own farms. My activity, my personal activity was the factory. Then the double activity of working the farm. I was a farmer with four or five cows. The factory was hard. We worked with a lot of gas. Gas for making a lot of chlorine, for making cobalt, and the work was hard.
What were some of the problems that you had in the early years of your farm corporation?
The problems were the little parcels of land. Since not everybody in town agreed with us, we had to go around quite a few in order to pasture our animals, go around a lot of different land parcels. Well, today the attitude towards the group is all right. They can see, after all, that the land is cleared rather than left to grow over. Some are reticent, but most are okay.
What was life like for you before this company got started?
Well, it was pretty hard, yes, because you see, I was the one who had the responsibility of taking care of the animals and everything else. So in the wintertime, I got up at 5 a.m. to milk the cows, and then I had to take the milk to the co-op. And when there was snow on the ground, I had to dig out a path from the house to the road. And then, well, I had to take care of the children and then get them ready for school. And then I had to go and get the hay ready. And finally, well, I was busy until time to make lunch. And at 3 p.m., it started all over again, feeding the cows again, milking, and the rest. I was busy until at least 6 p.m. or later.
And how did life change for you after the company got started?
Oh, yes, much less to worry about. I didn't have to take care of the cows anymore, either in the winter or the nice weather when they had to be taken to pasture. And then all the other stuff, the hay and all that, it was already different. I didn't have to work in the morning, whereas before I had to get up early to rake the hay and rush back to get breakfast ready for the kids. Rush back because my husband arrived at 1 p.m. Get back in order to get everything ready on time. Once the corporation was set up, I only had my afternoon work to do. For me, it was vacation time. Oh, how I appreciated it. It was around 1975. The village's population was going down and its agricultural activity was disappearing, because the older farmers, the active ones, were reaching the age of 60, and there wasn't anybody to take over those small farms that had a maximum of 15 cows. It's true that a group of young people decided to give agriculture a new start, work their family farms, but not at all the same way. They put everything together, not only so they could have more free time, but also to have a more dynamic, more modern operation.
And do you have other activities besides agriculture?
I personally am very involved in agrotourism. My husband and I have two bed and breakfast that can host five people each. Other shareholders have guest rooms. There's a whole group of farmers in the valley who have organized walking trails that connect to the farms in the high mountain pastures. That combines walking, the discovery of those beautiful pastures, the plants and animals of the mountains, the old farmhouses, the cattle herds, the people who live here, local products, and the entire agro-pastoral system.
You help each other out quite a bit in this work, don't you?
It's an old tradition. And now, with our farm company, we're organized as a group of farmers together. Our animals don't belong to us individually anymore. We're all shareholders. It's really the same, only the structure is different. It's a lot like what our parents did. We were lucky that our ancestors, parents, and other people devoted to the mountains fought for us so that we could have a high-quality product before it became popular. We really couldn't do anything but produce a high-quality product. It was hard to get machinery up here. We had to have a quality product to survive. We went against the current in the 70s, a time when all you were supposed to do was produce. And now we can measure the results. Tons of people come to visit so that they can see how a high-quality product is made. That explains how we can get a good price for our milk and make a living from mountain agriculture.
Mrs. Ducognon, we saw a pretty incredible machine earlier.
It's not French machinery. I told you that mountain agriculture is of little importance, doesn't mean much to French agriculture. So we don't have French machinery to work on the hillsides. You saw how steep they are and how we've mechanized everything. We bring our hay in with that machine. It's a hay bin made in Austria.
Beaufort is a cheese that's been made for generations, for hundreds of years. It was a product of the high alpine pastures, mainly in the Beaufort region, but also in Tarentaise. And it's hard to farm these pastures. They're so steep and high up. They start around 4,500 feet and go all the way to 7,500. And when you get up to 4,500 in the spring, there's still snow higher up, so you have to pasture in stages. We milked. From the herd, we made cheese on the spot. The cows were milked tied to stakes. And right afterwards, the cheese was made. That's why we had such high quality milk. It came from the high alpine grass that is so rich in flavor. It was an expensive cheese. People didn't eat it very often because it cost too much. They kept it to sell. It was only offered on holidays or during family reunions or important dinners. The rest was exported. It was sold to rich people in the cities who could afford it. But it was also sold farther away, in Italy, and even to the French. We weren't part of France at that time. It was also used by ships. Beaufort is a cheese that keeps a long time. The Beaufort system was called an agro-pastoral system. It worked fine, but had a serious crisis during the 50s and 60s. Why? It wasn't really the system itself. Technically, it was okay. It had just become too old. Everything was done by hand, transportation by mule, cutting hay with a sickle, people walking the hay in on their backs. And up in the mountains, they milked by hand. It was very labor intensive. Two things happened. The previously abundant workforce dried up because of the development of the tourist industry, with ski resorts and dams built by the electric company. And then metallurgical factories in the valleys. So young people didn't want to do this kind of hard work, which paid less. And also, products like Beaufort cheese lost their value. Mountain products and livestock went down in value compared to the previous decades and even centuries. So we created co-ops. People said, it costs too much, it's harder, we don't have enough skilled labor and cheesemakers to continue production up in the high pastures. We'll collect the milk and take it to a cheese factory and make Beaufort cheese there. It was a good idea, except that when they started making Beaufort cheese with transported milk, it didn't work. The method of production was changed. And that's when we got lucky. We got in touch with the National Institute of Agricultural Research, and in particular, the head of the department responsible for milk research, who helped us solve all the technical problems leading to our new system for making Beaufort cheese.
Maxime, what does the word quality mean to you?
There are a lot of things in quality. First, it suggests something that's good for you, healthy, something you can have confidence in. Secondly, it has to look good, be excellent. As a matter of fact, you can find what we call the land in its texture. The land is, well, it's the soil. It comes from the geological structure, the plants, the atmospheric conditions, and the human know-how. Those are the things. That's what you find in quality.
What is your opinion of the farm company up in Granier?
Well, it sure left its mark on a lot of people. It was really lucky for the region, for agriculture in Granier. And really, it happened because of their spirit, the community spirit in Granier. Our story starts in 1975, when we realized that the civilization that preceded us was about to disappear. We wanted to leave our mark on that world. We didn't want to be a generation of quitters. We wanted to pass along the baton that our parents gave us. Life had remained fairly traditional, hadn't changed much for centuries. Since back in those times, a lot of the farm work was still done by manual labor, without using machines or gasoline. We had to make that transition between traditional farm work and the imperatives of modern economics.
Was there an exodus from the country?
Yes, everyone was leaving to go to town, or at the very least, moving to a salaried job and abandoning farming. Some of them had two activities. They wanted a salary from a job in town in the valleys, but then came back to work on the farm in the time remaining. On the other hand, others just left the farm and never came back. There were very few of us who kept up a double activity that would let us save pastoral living. We wanted to continue the work of our ancestors. We wanted to pass along all the wealth that came from them, from their traditions, from the past of our village, our community. We wanted to transmit it to our children, pass the torch. We did it by using our wealth. Part of that wealth was a sense of community. So we thought about how a group of people ready to fight could keep living the pastoral life that was part of our family tree and still make it economically viable, still keep up the tradition that was our heritage. We looked for formulas that would respect the traditional way of life, that is, traditional agriculture, and which would also fit into the needs of contemporary living. We brought in a lot of modern technology. We built buildings that made the job easier. We bought machines that could operate on our land in the difficult mountain terrain. And then, little by little, with some imagination, we managed to find all the technology that has allowed us to be economically viable. Our goal is a decent life with enough to live from our work. And I think we managed to attain it thanks to the farm work and parallel activities like rural tourism, enough income to give us a decent life.
René, do you think that it's possible to reproduce what you have done here anywhere in the world?
You can't reproduce what we did, because what we did had to adapt to the particular conditions of our village, our community, and our own situation. On the other hand, reproducing the social model that we created, I mean, getting people together with a clear goal, people ready to fight to attain that goal, assuming that they're all top-notch people, I think that's possible anywhere in the world.
This is not just the story of some brave and determined people. It somehow penetrates deeply into the way we choose to live and the meanings we attach to our choices. Their high-quality product and the technical innovations that allowed these people to live a decent life in the modern world are only one level of the story. On a deeper plane, these people are living a harmonious life that embraces the past and the future. They're convinced that the wisdom of their ancestors is a real heritage, a wealth that has been nurtured and passed along to them. It's not a tangible wealth in the strictest sense of the word, but rather a holistic wealth that encompasses physical and spiritual ways for them to be happy with their fellow human beings. And all of the things that we cherish can be found in their example. Individuality, love of family, working together, democratic decision-making, love of tradition, advanced knowledge and technology, education, care for the land and the environment, and a deep sense of community. These are the real elements that can be found in the word quality.
Thank you.